Reading through the Bible in 1 year, May 3rd, Numbers chapter 10, Psalms 46 through 47, Song of Solomon, or Song of Songs, chapter 8, in Hebrews chapter 8. The Lord spoke further to Moses, saying, "Make yourself two trumpets of silver, of hammered work you shall make them, and you shall use them for summoning the congregation and for having the camp set out. When both are blown, all the congregation shall gather themselves to you at the doorway of the tent of meeting. Yet if only one is blown, then the leaders, the heads of the divisions of Israel, shall assemble before you. But when you blow an alarm, the camps that are pitched on the east side shall set out. But when you blow an alarm the second time, the camps that are pitched on the south side shall set out. An alarm is to be blown for them to set out. When convening the assembly, however, you shall blow without sounding an alarm. The priestly sons of Aaron, moreover, shall blow the trumpets. This shall be for you a perpetual statute throughout your generations. When you go out to war in your land against the adversary who attacks you, then you shall sound an alarm with the trumpets, that you may be remembered before your Lord, rather before the Lord your God, and be saved from all your enemies. Also, in the day of your gladness, and in the..." I'm going to bring this note up here because it's very long. I want to make sure you get all of that. Also, in the day of your gladness, and in your appointed feasts, and on the... That jumped way ahead. Also, in the day of your gladness, and in your appointed feasts, and on the first days of your months, you shall blow the trumpets with your burnt offerings, and over the sacrifices of your peace offerings. And they shall be as a reminder of you before your God. I am the Lord your God. Now, in the second year, in the second month, on the 20th of the month, the cloud was lifted from over the tabernacle of the testimony. And the sons of Israel set out on their journeys from the wilderness of Sinai. Then the cloud settled down in the wilderness of Paran. So they moved out for the first time according to the commandment of the Lord through Moses. The standard of the camp of the sons of Judah, according to their armies, set out first with Nathan, the son of Abinadab, over its army. And Nethanel, the son of Zuar, over the tribal army of the sons of Issachar. And Eliab, the son of Helon, over the tribal army of the sons of Zebulun. Then the tabernacle was taken down, and the sons of Gershon and the sons of Merari, who were carrying the tabernacle, set out. Next, the standard of the camp of Reuben, according to their armies, set out with Eleazar, the son of Shedeur, over its army, and Shelomiel, the son of Zurishaddai, over the tribal army of the sons of Simeon. Then Eliasaph, the son of Deuel, was over the tribal army of the sons of Gad. Then the Kohathites set out, carrying the holy objects, and the tabernacle was set up before their arrival. Next, the standard of the camp of the sons of Ephraim, according to their armies, was set out with Elishama, the son of Amihud, over its army, and Gamaliel, the son of Pedazur, over the tribal army of the sons of Manasseh, and Abadan, the son of Gideoni, over the tribal army of the sons of Benjamin. Then the standard of the camps of the sons of Dan, according to their armies, which formed the rear guard for all the camps set out, with Ahiezer, the son of Amashirai, over its army, and Pagiel, the son of Ochran, over the tribal army of the sons of Asher, and Ahira, the son of Enan, over the tribal army of the sons of Naphtali. This was the order of the march of the sons of Israel by their armies as they set out. Then Moses said to Hobab, the son of Reuel, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law, "We are setting out to the place of which the Lord said, 'I will give it to you.' Come with us, and we will do to you good. Rather, we will do you good. For the Lord has promised good concerning Israel." But he said to them, or rather, he said to him, "I will not come, but rather I will go to my own land and relatives." Then he said, "Please do not leave us. Inasmuch as you know where we should camp in the wilderness, and you will be as eyes for us." So it will be if you go with us, that wherever the good Lord does for us, that whatever the good Lord does for us, will we do for you. We will do for you. This is a very hard book to read. Not in general. I just mean the NASB, the wording's kind of wooden, and it's kind of hard to get around. Thus they will set out from the mount of the Lord 3 days' journey with the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, journeying in front of them for the 3 days, to seek out a resting place for them. The cloud of the Lord was over them by day when they set out from the camp. Then it came about, when the Ark set out, that Moses said, "Rise up, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let those who hate you flee from before you." When it came to rest, he said, "Return, O Lord, to the myriad thousands of Israel." Bring up the rest of the note here for you, or notes. All right, there we go. Let's go on to Psalms chapter 46 through 47. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, and though the mountains slip into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake at its swelling pride. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations made an uproar. The kingdoms tottered. He raised his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has wrought desolations in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots with fire. Cease striving and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Psalm 47. O clap your hands, all peoples. Shout to God with the voice of joy. For the Lord Most High is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He subdues peoples under us, and nations under our feet. He chooses our nations. He chooses our inheritance for us, the glory of Jacob, whom he loves. God has ascended with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a skillful psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the people have assembled themselves as the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. And that's all the notes. Let's go on to Song of Songs or Song of Solomon, chapter 8. This is, again, the woman speaking to her husband. Oh, that you were like a brother to me, who nursed at my mother's breasts. Remember the whole brother-sister thing where it's basically the saying that they just want to be very close together, not that they were actually brother and sister. Right. If I found you outdoors, I would kiss you. No one would despise me either. I would lead you and bring you into the house of my mother, who used to instruct me. I would give you spiced wine to drink from the juice of my pomegranates. Let his left hand be under my head and his right hand embrace me. I want you to swear, O daughters of Jerusalem, not to arouse or awaken my love until she pleases. Who is this, coming up from the wilderness, leaning on her beloved? Beneath the apple tree, I awakened you. There your mother was in labor with you. There she was in labor and gave you birth. Put me like a seal over your heart, like a seal on your arm. For love is as strong as death. Jealousy is as severe as Sheol. That its flashes are flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love, nor will rivers overflow it. If a man were to give all the riches of his house for love, it would be utterly despised. We have a little sister, and she has no breasts. What shall we do for our sister on the day when she is spoken for? If she is a wall, we will build on her a battlement of silver. But if she is a door, we will barricade her with planks of cedar. You might be like, what? Okay, basically saying, when somebody comes up to her to, let me read the notes on this because it's a little bit, it gets a little funky. It's not bad. It's not bad at all, but it's at least good to understand. So, where's verse 8? There we go. The chorus speaks here, anticipating the woman's speech in 10 through 12. A day when she is spoken for is the day when the little sister will marry. A wall carries the idea of resistance and probably refers to a chaste woman. A door, which can be closed or open, is an image of either cooperating with the wall or defying it, as in promiscuity. Which is why they say that they will build on her battlements of silver or barricade her with planks of cedar. They're going to defend her honor regardless of how she acts. Verse 10. I was a wall and my breasts were like towers. When I became in his eyes as one who finds peace, Solomon had a vineyard at Baal Hamon. He entrusted the vineyard to caretakers. Each one was to bring 1,000 shekels of silver for its fruit. My very own vineyard is at my disposal. 1,000 shekels are for you, Solomon, and 200 are for those who take care of its fruit. You who sit in the gardens, my companions are listening for your voice. Let me hear it. Hurry, my beloved, and be like a gazelle or a young stag on the mountains of spices. Bringing up the rest of the notes here for you. There are quite a few. And as usual, the ESV Study Bible tends to be jumping around quite a bit. So I'm going to make sure you get all of those in here. There we go. All right, let's move on to the final book of the night, Hebrews chapter 8. The author of Hebrews continues. Now, the main point in what has been said is this. We have such a high priest who has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister in the sanctuary and in the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched, not man. For every year, a high priest is appointed, rather, for every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices. So it is necessary that his high priest also has something to offer. Or that, rather, that this high priest also has something to offer. Now, if he were on earth, he would not be a priest at all, since there are those who offer the gifts according to the law, who serve a copy and a shadow of the heavenly things. Just as Moses was warned by God when he was about to erect the tabernacle, for see, he says, that you make all things according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain. But now he has obtained a much more excellent ministry, by as much as he also is the mediator of a better covenant, which has been enacted on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion sought for a second. For finding fault with them, he says, "Behold, days are coming, says the Lord, when I will effect a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not like the covenant which I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. For they did not continue in my covenant. This is the covenant of works and the law. For they did not continue in my covenant, and I did not care for them, says the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws into their minds, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. They shall not teach everyone his fellow citizen, and everyone his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they will all know me, from the least to the greatest of them. For I will be merciful to their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. See, the law only remembers sins. There is no forgiveness in the law. The law is the standard. Remember how we talked about yesterday, right? The law is the standard where God says you must be this holy, this perfect to enter my rest. You must never tell a lie. From the moment you're born until the moment you die, you must never steal anything, even time. You must always do that which honors God in everything that you do. Your thoughts must only be about that which honors God in all of your thoughts that you have. You must never covet. You must never lust after someone who is not your wife or is not your husband. You have to do these things perfectly. And the minute you fail against them, then you have failed in all of them. There is no forgiveness in the law. God allows for some, for covering of those sins. But there is no forgiveness given. This is what the new covenant offers. This is why it's a better covenant, because there is forgiveness under this. This is why we see in verse 12 a reiteration, for I will be merciful to their iniquities. The law is not merciful. The law can only declare that you have violated this law. And it concludes with, and I will remember their sins no more. When he said a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. Why? Because he replaced it. But whatever is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to disappear. I'm going to bring up the notes here because they are very, very long. They're very good, so I strongly recommend reading them. But they are long, and I want to make sure that you have them available to you. Yep, there we go. And we will be back tomorrow. Behold the word of the Lord.